Good afternoon, everybody. Good to see you all. Good to be able to join together for worship this Sunday. Whether you're here in the church or joining us online, we do hope you have a sense of welcome and a sense of God's presence and blessing as we worship Him together. Just one announcement to bring to your attention, and that's to say that the midweek Bible study and prayer meeting this week will be in the Atchison Hall, but there's a change of time. It will be at 8:30 this week instead of the usual 8 o'clock. So it's 8:30 for the midweek Bible study and prayer meeting, Atchison Hall on Wednesday. And as always, you're very much encouraged to come along. But as we begin, I'm going to turn to the 100th Psalm, and I'm going to read verses 1 to 3. It says, it's a psalm for giving thanks. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before Him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It's He who made us, and we are His. We are His people, the sheep of His pasture. Amen. Let's stand and sing that psalm together. All people that on earth do dwell. Let's join and praise God together. Join together in prayer. Let's pray. For the Lord is good, and His love endures forever. Father, we thank You for the words of the psalm that we've just read and sung. Words of praise and words of thanks. Words that call us to worship You with thankfulness, with gladness, and with joy. And as we come to You now in worship, we rejoice in You as the true God, the God who is holy and just, the God who is almighty and everlasting, the creator of the ends of the earth. We praise You, for You are a giving God, a gracious God, a God who loved the world so much that You gave Your only begotten Son, that You gave Your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, that through faith in Him, we would not perish, but instead be given the joy the unspeakable joy of eternal life. We thank you, Lord, for how in Christ you've lavished your love on us, that you've poured out grace upon grace, that in him we've all received one blessing after another. Yet, Lord, we confess before you that all too often we take your grace for granted. We all too easily forget to count our blessings, forget to look to your generosity, your care for us. We forget to thank you, let alone come with thankful hearts moment by moment. Forgive us, we pray. And as we ask for forgiveness, we also thank you for the promises of your word. Your promises that tell us that it's as far as the east is from the west. That's how far you've removed our transgressions from us. And it's as high as the heavens are above the earth. That's how great your love is for those who fear you. Father, our heart's desire this morning is to meet with you. To meet with you, trusting that as we do so, that you will strengthen our hearts by your grace. Trusting that as we draw near to you, that you will purify our hearts, transform our minds, renew our faith, and bring forth the fruits of the Holy Spirit in our lives. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. So today I want to begin just a short series, a mini-series I suppose you would say, looking at the lost and found stories in Luke chapter 15. So today we turn to the first part. It's the parable or the story of the lost sheep. And we can find it in Luke 15 verses 1 to 7. If you have a Bible there, do please turn with me. The words will appear on the screen, but it will be helpful to have a Bible open as we look at it later on. But Luke 15 verses 1 to 7, let us hear the word of God. Luke 15, reading from verse 1. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear him. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." Then Jesus told this parable. Suppose one of you has 100 sheep and loses one of them. Does he not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And when he finds it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulders and goes home. Then he calls his friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me, I have found my lost sheep." I tell you that in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent. Amen. We thank the Lord for this reading of his word. Our children's talk today is going to be taken by the McMinn children, so it'll appear on the screen. And our thanks go to them.
Luke chapter 15, verses 1 to 7. Many tax collectors and sinners came to hear what Jesus had to say. The Pharisees and the teachers of the law began to complain. "Look, this man welcomes sinners and even eats with them." Then Jesus told them the story about the lost sheep.
'97, '98, '99. Where's Lambert? Where's 100? I'll have to start again. 1, 2, 3, 97, 98, 99. I've lost a sheep. Where is Lambert?
Oh no.
Oh no, I have to go and find him.
Even though the shepherd has 99 sheep, He still has to leave them to go and look for this one lost sheep because he cares for them all.
Barney, stay here. I'm going to find the lost sheep. I hope he finds baby Lambert.
There will be much joy in heaven for that one lost sinner who changes his heart and accepts Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior.
Are you a lost sheep?
Jesus is the good shepherd and he wants you to be in heaven. Pray to him today.
We'll sing our song together now. I'm trying to think what you call it. It'll come up anyway. I just want to be a fool. Okay, so we've looked at the story of the lost sheep, and sheep and shepherds, of course, are an image or a picture that come up a lot in the Bible. And I'm going to read another passage now in Ezekiel 34. And this whole chapter looks at the question of sheep, of shepherds and sheep, and the biblical meaning of it. And so we're going to read verses 11 to 16. So Ezekiel 34, verses 11 to 16. Let's hear God's word. For this is what the Sovereign Lord says. I myself will search for the sheep and look after them. As a shepherd looks after his scattered flock when he is with them, so I will look after my sheep. I will rescue them from all the places where they were scattered on a day of clouds and darkness. I will bring them out from the nations and gather them from the countries, and I will bring them into their own land. I will pasture them on the mountains of Israel, in the ravines and in all the settlements of the land. I will tend them in a good pasture, and the mountain heights of Israel will be their grazing land. There they will lie down in good grazing land, and there they will feed in a rich pasture on the mountains of Israel. I myself will tend my sheep and make them lie down, declares the Sovereign Lord. I will search for the lost and bring back the strays. I will bind up the injured and strengthen the weak, but the sleek and the strong I will destroy. I will shepherd the flock with justice. Amen. So before we turn to our study of God's word, we're going to pray together. So let's pray. And as we pray, we're going to dedicate the offering and ask for God's help as we look to his word. So let's pray. Father, we thank you for all your blessings to us. We thank you for the blessings of this day and the blessing of being able to join in fellowship and worship here this afternoon. And we thank you, Lord, for the blessing of being able to contribute to your work through the offering. We pray that you'd receive our offerings and bless them and use them in the building of Christ's church here in this place and further afield. And Father, we also thank you for your word to us in the two passages we've read together. As we come now to study your word, we pray that you would grant us help and understanding. That as we look at the story of the lost sheep, that you would open it to us, that you would come and help us hear your voice, that we would be changed by your Spirit through Christ our Lord. Amen. Now, I don't have a sheep with me today, but I do have a teddy bear. And this is Whitey. And I have a special story about Whitey. And Whitey was a teddy I got when I was 5 years old. Because I had another teddy, a very special teddy called Snowy. And I loved Snowy. But you know what happened the summer I turned 5? I lost Snowy. And we searched high and low all around the house, but we couldn't find him anywhere, and I was very sad. But eventually, we gave up, and I thought, well, I'm just going to have to ask for a new Snowy for Christmas. So when it came to writing my Christmas, what I would like for Christmas, I put a new Snowy, because I thought Snowy will never be found. So it was came to Christmas Eve then, and my granny was coming to stay at our house. So when Gran came to stay, she stayed in my room, and I went to stay in my big brother's room. So Jeff, he wanted to sleep in the sleeping bag on the floor, so I slept in his bed. So I was nearly asleep, but then Jeff got into the sleeping bag. And he went to put his feet at the bottom of the sleeping bag, and he said, "Here, Mark, there's something at the bottom of this sleeping bag." I said, "Well, get it out and we'll see what it is." So he got down, and what was it? Well, it was Snowy. And the two of us ran down the stairs. We were screaming with delight, cheering with delight, because we'd found Snowy, because Snowy had been lost, but was then found. And we were rejoicing because Snowy was lost and then found. Where does Whitey come into the story? Well, the next morning, from a Christmas presents, opened them up, and there he was, the new Snowy, or Whitey, as he was called. So I then had Snowy and Whitey. So they've had a very special place ever since that. So that's Snowy. He still looks a bit grumpy. He always did. But that's Snowy. So that was a story, a real life story, of a teddy bear being lost and found, and about our excitement, our rejoicing, our happiness when we found the lost teddy. Now, the story today, the passage today, is a story about something being lost and found, and about great rejoicing when that thing is found. And it's the same for this whole chapter. We'll see it next week, and then a couple of weeks later on Children's Day, because we'll see a lost sheep, a lost coin, a lost son. And each time we see they're lost, and then found. And on each occasion, there's great joy, great rejoicing, great happiness that that thing that was lost has been found. Now, I'm going to think a wee bit more about the joy aspect next week when we look at the lost coin. But for this morning, I want to focus on the story of the lost sheep and think about, but why did Jesus tell this story in the first place? You see, the three stories, the lost sheep, lost coin, lost son, are all part of the one parable. They're all three parts of the same parable. But why did Jesus tell this parable? What was it that prompted Jesus to tell this parable? What was the point he was trying to get across in telling this? What was he saying in these words? That's what we're going to think about today. And as we see, he told it because there were people both coming to hear him, but also people coming and muttering as well. And he told this parable as a rebuke. This parable was told as a rebuke. Told as a rebuke to the Pharisees and the teachers of the law. To say to them, your attitude's wrong. Your thinking's wrong. Your hearts are wrong. You aren't thinking the way God thinks. You aren't thinking the way you should be thinking. Your hearts aren't where they should be. That's what Jesus says through this parable. It was a rebuke to them for their cold-heartedness, for their hard-heartedness, for their lack of love, their lack of care towards others. It's an attitude in stark contrast to the shepherd. The shepherd who goes after the lost sheep and who rejoices when he comes home and finds it, or when he finds it. And then when he comes home, he calls his neighbors to rejoice as well. It's a passage, like all of Jesus' teaching, that challenges us as well. And it challenges us with this question. Does our attitude more reflect that of Jesus, the shepherd, or that of the Pharisees? When it comes to thinking about those who are outside God's kingdom, when it comes to thinking about those who don't know Jesus, are we more like Jesus, the good shepherd, or are we more like the Pharisees? Are we like Jesus, who loved those outside his kingdom, who loved those who didn't know him, and longed for them to know him? Or are we like the Pharisees, who at best couldn't care less, and at worst didn't even want other people to come into God's kingdom? That's the question we have to face today, the question we have to ask ourselves. So what do we see in this passage? Well, one of the first things we see is a great division, you might say, between the Pharisees and scribes on the one hand, and then the tax collectors and sinners, as they saw them, on the other hand. A great division in how they respond to Jesus. You've got those who we read are tax collectors and sinners, grouping of people. They're coming around to hear Jesus, to listen to Jesus, to find out what Jesus has to say. But instead, you've got the Pharisees and the tax collector, Pharisees and the scribes. They're religious people, the people you would think would want to hear from Jesus. Instead, they're muttering. They're muttering and murmuring. What is it they're saying? Well, they're talking under their breath. Would you look at him? Would you look at that Jesus? He talks with those tax collectors, those sinners. He even eats with them. That's the kind of thing they were saying. They're muttering about Jesus. They're judging him. They're judging him for socializing, for engaging with those who they regard as far from God, as outside God's kingdom. They think any kind of religious person, any kind of teacher, let alone somebody who claims to be God, they would know the kind of people these are. They would know who they are talking to, and they would avoid them like the plague. That's what they did, and they think that's what Jesus should do as well. You see, there were certain beliefs the Pharisees held, certain assumptions they made. And one of those primary assumptions they made was that they were a part of God's kingdom. That they were a part of God's kingdom because they were good enough. That they were a part of God's kingdom because of their morality. That they were the keepers of the law. They did everything right. So God thought they were good enough. They definitely thought they were good enough. And they thought, God loves us. We are God's people because we are good enough people. That's what they thought. They made assumptions about themselves. But they also then made assumptions about other people. They made assumptions about people like tax collectors, people who they saw in this wide group of sinners. They thought, well, they're not our kind of people. They're not good enough. They're immoral, so they aren't in God's kingdom. That's one of the assumptions the Pharisees made. That's what they thought. They regarded those who were different, who were outside the kingdom, to be avoided at all costs. That's why they mutter at this stage. And it's in a response to this muttering that Jesus brings us this parable. The first part, of course, is the story of the lost sheep, which we're looking at today. And as I've said, this imagery of sheep and shepherds is very familiar throughout the Bible. You have things like the 100th Psalm. We read there that we are the sheep of God's pasture. We read from Ezekiel 34, a passage that focuses on sheep and shepherds and how we're described as sheep. God's people are described as sheep, but also how God appoints shepherds to care for us, to lead us, to teach us. And that was the role the Pharisees should have been doing. But also then we see things like another obvious example, the 23rd Psalm, the Lord is my shepherd. So that's three examples of many that speak about sheep and shepherds in the Old Testament. And in taking on this parable here, and the way it teaches that Jesus is taking on those descriptions on himself, he is saying, all the things the shepherds should be doing, I do. I care for the people. I watch over the people. I teach the people the way you should be teaching them. Jesus takes the descriptions on himself. He's saying, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd who cares for the sheep. The Pharisees would get this. They would get that Jesus was saying, I'm doing what you aren't doing. I'm doing the job you should be doing. Notice with me as we think about the passage here, the question in verse 4. He's addressing the Pharisees. He says to them, suppose one of you Pharisees, has 100 sheep and loses one of them. Does he not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? Now, something we need to assume at this stage is that the 99 are safe. Is that either there's an assistant shepherd or they're left in a sheep pen or something. We need to assume the 99 are safe. So Jesus says, which of you would go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And we think the answer would be, well, everybody would. Of course, that's what you would do. That's what we expect the answer to be. But the answer for the Pharisees would be a resounding no. We would not go after the lost sheep. We would not go after those who have strayed. If you're talking about these tax collectors and sinners, we would not go after them to try to bring them back. We wouldn't do that. There's no way the Pharisees would go to trouble to potentially defile themselves, as they would say it, by mixing with those who were not the right kind of people, not religious, as they were. That's what they would have thought. And the Pharisees were very quick to put people into categories. Pharisees good, tax collectors bad, religious people good, sinners bad, shepherds bad, as they would have seen it. You see, they thought shepherds were kind of dirty people, people who were untrustworthy, who made money by taking their sheep to somebody else's land. That's how they thought of the shepherds. They wouldn't have wanted to be compared to shepherds. And the Pharisees liked putting people into categories. We see this in Luke 7. There Jesus is anointed by what we read as a sinful woman. And she comes to Jesus. She's in tears. She wets his feet. She also pours perfume on his feet. Then she dries his feet with her hair. And all this happens at a Pharisee's house. And the Pharisee sees all this, and he says, if this man were a prophet, he would know who is touching him and what kind of woman she is, that she's a sinner. So the Pharisee has put that woman into a category bad. Also then we see it in Matthew 9, where Jesus calls Matthew the tax collector. Jesus sees the person, but if you look at the passage, all the Pharisees see is Jesus eating with tax collectors and sinners, people who they've categorized as bad, as not good enough for God, as not good enough to be accepted by God. But it's not just the Pharisees who put people in categories. We see the disciples do it as well. Luke 18, a few chapters on from this, we see people bringing babies or infants to Jesus to touch them. What do the disciples do? What's their default? Will they rebuke the people? They say, you know, they kind of turn them away, but Jesus says, don't rebuke them, let them come to me. Jesus' default response is to bless, to welcome. You see, Jesus sees people as people. He doesn't see people in categories that he writes off, but Jesus sees people as individuals. Individuals, human beings that he cares for, that he loves, that he wants to know him, that he wants to welcome and draw to him. He doesn't write people off the way the Pharisees do, but he wants to welcome people, whoever they are, that they would come to him and give their lives to him. I wonder, do we ever put people in categories when it comes to faith? Do we ever think about people, well, they wouldn't be interested in hearing about Jesus. They're from the wrong religious background, or they've got the wrong politics, or they're too rich, they're too poor, or they wouldn't want to hear about Jesus. Do we ever write people off? Jesus doesn't do that. Jesus looks in people as individuals that he loves, individuals that he wants to come to him, individuals that he wants to know him. You know, there wasn't anything special about the lost sheep in the story. It wasn't that this sheep was more loved than the others, but this sheep was just an individual that the shepherd cared for enough to go after. You know, there's nothing special about you or me, but if we've trusted in Christ, it's because Jesus cared us. It's because Jesus brought us to himself, because Jesus drew us to himself, that we were lost, but in Christ now we're found. We think about the song Amazing Grace. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. That if we know Christ, that's our testimony. We can say that. We were helpless, just the way the sheep here is helpless. What can a lost sheep do to help itself be found? Not much. What would have happened to the sheep there? Well, it would have got lost. Maybe it would have realized it was lost, would have been terrified, perhaps would have tried to hide behind a rock or something, would have been bleating, trying to call the people. But instead, either a wild animal would have heard and attacked the sheep, or the shepherd got there first. The shepherd didn't have much time, but the shepherd had to get there to rescue the sheep, the helpless and powerless sheep. The sheep contributes nothing to its rescue here, other than its need, other than its helplessness. It's a reminder that we contribute nothing to our salvation other than our need, other than our helplessness, other than our sin and our need of forgiveness. The shepherd here cares. He cares enough to search, to find, and when he finds the sheep, he joyfully puts them on his shoulders and he carries them home. The shepherd does it because he cares. He does it because he loves the flock, the sheep of his pasture. Of course, this isn't the only time Jesus speaks about a shepherd who loves his sheep. Another example comes where he says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The shepherd in our story today goes to find the sheep at cost to himself. He puts himself in danger. He goes through physical effort to find the sheep. But Jesus, as the good shepherd, didn't just go to danger or physical effort, but he went to the cross. He went to his death. It wasn't just the trials of the wilderness Jesus went through, but the trials of the cross. That's where we see the good shepherd lay down his life for the sheep. That's where we see Jesus lay down his life for you and for me. Sheep who were lost, sheep who were in need, sheep who were helpless, who could do nothing to rescue ourselves other than accept the shepherd as our saviour. Imagine for a moment with me as we finish the impact of this story on the listeners of the day. Because yes, Jesus' primary audience were the Pharisees and the scribes, the teachers of the law. But also, you can be sure that the sinners, the tax collectors, as they're described here, would have heard the words as well. So how would they have heard the words? Well, the tax collectors and sinners would have heard these words, and it would have had an impact upon them. They wanted to hear from Jesus. They gathered to hear from Jesus. They were listening to Jesus. And they were those who'd been told, you aren't good enough to come to God. God doesn't care for you. God doesn't want you to know him. But Jesus here says to them, I love you. I care for you. I want you to come to God. I'm the shepherd who will give my life for you to come to God. I have come to seek and save you. I have come to seek and save the lost. I have come to seek and save the lost that they would know me as Lord. Jesus says, I've come that you would know me. Jesus here is calling the lost sheep to himself. He's calling the tax collectors and sinners to himself. And he's saying, you don't need to worry about what you've done. You don't need to worry about how others think of you. Because I love you and I want you to come to me. I want you to receive me as Lord and Savior. That's why I came to this earth, to die on the cross, to die as the good shepherd who draws the sheep to himself. Jesus would have said to them, you can come to me. You don't need to worry about what they say, but I love you. So come and receive my welcome and forgiveness. And that was the impact there. But what about the impact on the Pharisees? Well, as I said, this parable was a challenge to them, a rebuke to them, a rebuke to them and their attitudes, a rebuke to them and their thinking, a rebuke to them and their thinking that they were the only ones God wanted to know, that they were happy with their holy huddle, they were happy with their exclusive club, that they didn't want anybody else in the kingdom. When Jesus says to them, that's not the way God thinks. That's not the way you should think. It's a rebuke to the Pharisees. I wonder if it's a rebuke to us as well. At the very least, it's a challenge to us. A challenge for us to ask the question, does our attitude reflect that of Jesus or the Pharisees? Are we those who pray for others, who seek to share Jesus with others, who long to see others come to know Jesus, who long to see others come into the church, not that the church would be filled, but that God would be glorified and people would worship him and honor him with their lives, and the name of Jesus would be lifted high. Do we think that, or are we more like the Pharisees in a way? That we aren't worried about others. We couldn't care about others. We're happy with things as they are. What's our thinking like? It can seem a bit vague if we think about people in general, but think about people you know, people who don't know Jesus. Will you pray for them? Will you pray for them and ask for God's work in their lives, that they would know that they're loved by him, that they would know that Jesus gave his life for them, and that they would trust him? We have good news to share. There's good news here in this chapter. Good news here in God's word. Good news here of a shepherd who lays down his life for the sheep. Good news of a Saviour who came to seek and save the lost. Good news of a Father who rejoices over one sinner who repents, over one person who realizes their need of a Saviour and who turns to Christ and puts their trust in Him. God rejoices at that. May we rejoice in it too. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this wonderful gospel picture we see in our passage today. This picture of how Christ came to seek and save us, of how we were helpless to save ourselves, of how we were lost, but of how Christ came to rescue us from our sin and reconcile us to Himself. Lord, we thank you that this isn't simply news for us, but it's good news for us to share. It's good news for all people. Lord, that you loved the world so much, not just us, but you loved the world so much that you gave your only begotten Son, that you gave Christ, that Christ came to seek and save the lost. Lord, we thank you for your saving work in our lives, that for those of us who've trusted you, we thank you for that day when you drew us to yourself and opened our hearts to the gospel. We pray you'd help us to live with thankfulness, help us to live with joy, a thankfulness and joy that would prompt us and lead us to pray for others, to share Christ with others, and to seek to be obedient to your call to make disciples. Lord, we pray for your blessing on us, and we pray also for your blessing on this world in which we live. And today as we gather, we think about the ongoing conflict that's been developing in Israel and Palestine. And we pray for an end to that fighting there. We pray, Father, that you would lay your hand upon that whole situation, the whole situation, to bring renewed peace to that part of the world. Guide political leaders there that they would make decisions that would be good and wise as they seek a way forward for all the people. And just as we pray for Israel, we also pray for India and Nepal and other countries where the rates of COVID-19 and infection and death remain high. Bless those lands, we pray. Bring healing to those who are sick and give your help to those who are treating them. Strengthen your people there as they seek to reach out and show your care and love to those around them, and as they seek to minister at this difficult time. Lord, we pray also for ourselves and the situations we find ourselves in, whether individually or in our families, in the congregation, or those we know and love. We pray for those who are sick, those who are sorrowing, those who are struggling in some way. You know each of our needs, our worries, our concerns. And we pray that in your mercy, you would draw alongside us to bring strength and healing and a reassurance of your care for us. We pray in the name of the Good Shepherd, the Lord Jesus. Amen. We'll join to sing our closing hymn, "The Lord's My Shepherd, and I Will Trust in Him Alone." Let's stand together. We finish by reading words from 1 Thessalonians 5 for the grace. Be joyful always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all this day and forevermore. Amen.